Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Arthur Murray Lifestyle Series. I'm Victoria Regan, the Global Ambassador for Arthur Murray International. When you are young, impressionable, and dream of being an artist, you are often discouraged from following your heart. The thought of instability frightens family, friends, and, well, anyone with a sound mind. However, if you meet mentors that are the best in the business, that is, in Arthur Murray's, you are on your way to an incredible discovery of both head and heart. Franchisee Brett Evans shares this experience with us and her journey to success, helping others, and happiness. Hello, Britt, and welcome to the Lifestyle Series. I'm so excited for you to share your story with us, but first, how are things going for you?
Thank you, Victoria. It is so great to be here, and what an honor to be asked to be a part of the Arthur Murray Lifestyle Series. I mean, good grief. That's really amazing. I'm on a very impressive list, and so I'm very humbled, so thank you. And you know, we're like everybody else. We're doing okay. It's an interesting, incredible time in history right now, but I'm very grateful to be a part of a larger organization. Kind of grounds me and ties me and keeps me going strong throughout all of this.
Let's go back to when you started with Arthur Murray's in Dallas. You took a sabbatical shortly after that. Why and where did you go?
Yeah, well, it's a funny story actually. I grew up in the Dallas area. My family's from there, and I really loved dancing. I was actually classically trained. I did jazz, ballet, theater, that type of thing. And so Arthur Murray's was supposed to be a pit stop on my way to Broadway. I wanted to be a Broadway dancer. You know how that is. And so I got into it my senior year of college. And what started out as a pit stop, I fell in love with it. I fell in love with the industry. I fell in love with the people. It showed me that I could have a life and a family and a lifestyle, and I could support a family in the arts and not be a starving artist, waiter, slash chorus girl, you know, that was the avenue for most classical dancers. So it was a sharp left turn in my life, but it was really great. However, after I graduated from college, I was still kind of on the fence. Well, maybe I need to go get a real job, whatever that is, the way my parents and a lot of other people were telling me to do. So I got an opportunity to go work a corporate position with a worldwide service industry in Paris, France. Who can say no to Paris, France, right? So I took about a 2-year hiatus and I moved to Paris. I didn't speak any French at the time. I learned it while I was there. And I had 2 incredible years. The company was a great company, but it was a corporate job. My personal life there was amazing. The food, the wine, the cafes, la vie bohème, all of those things happened in Paris. And while my personal life was just incredibly rich and full, what was weird was, you know, you spend 3/4 of your day in your job, and if that is not impactful or meaningful, it just kind of sucks the soul out of you. And that's what I found was happening for me. Even though I loved everything about Paris and I loved my personal life, the work wasn't meaningful and it didn't have an impact. And I decided I would go back to the ballroom industry and go back to the arts.
Claudia and Zach, give us some insight on how they've influenced you both personally and in your career.
Yeah, they were very big influences. Obviously, the first people that train you have a deep impact in your life, but they're wonderful, great people. And they take the training and the mentoring very seriously. Of course, they taught me the dancing, and they brought in top consultants on a regular basis that groomed our dancing and brought that up to the highest level. And they taught me how to teach a lesson and how to enroll people on programs and all that kind of stuff. But when I really think about it, I think the biggest influence was this. They kind of got me involved in personal growth, personal motivation, that type of stuff. And it all started my very first year. I was only 20 when I started with them. I was just a baby. But they took us to a seminar that Zig Ziglar was speaking in. And anyone who's heard Zig Ziglar has usually been very deeply impacted and touched. But I remember him looking out in the audience and saying, "You can have anything you want in life if you help enough other people get what they want." And I heard that and it struck a deep chord in my spirit. And I went to the back of the room that very day and bought his book. And I started a very lifelong, profitable journey of self-motivation, personal growth. And it started really at that seminar. And I just devoured books. Todd Duncan and Tom Hopkins and everything Zig Ziglar had and John Maxwell. And it really shapes and forms me every year and grows me every year. So I think that was probably the biggest influence, because once you start to really grow personally and take that journey and make it a part of your lifestyle, doors open up, things happen.
You've mentioned John Maxwell in a lot of your seminars. Do you feel he's given you an even stronger voice?
Yeah, you know, John Maxwell, the way that Zig Ziglar said helping people, that got me service related. And I think John Maxwell, his big focus is that everything rises and falls on leadership. And so once I started really incorporating his leadership principles into my life is when things started to change. In our industry, we change people's lives and we make big impacts in their lives through the dancing, but we do it through a team of people. And so your leadership skills and how you negotiate teams of artistic types really can dictate how successful you are. And he was really key with that. It shaped the way that we run our business, the decisions that we make, who we hire, how we hire, and how we train. And so that has been a very huge influence in my life and continues to be.
We know that you're not alone in all these amazing achievements. So let's welcome Douglas in to share a few stories about meeting, dancing together, and maybe some work ethics.
It was the staff Christmas party, actually, and we had just been best friends up to this point, but we were exchanging gifts, and normal gifts at a staff Christmas party are, you know, a mug or a calendar or something simple like that. But I opened up this gift from Douglas, and it was a tan suede coat, gorgeous coat. And I thought, whoa, this is a big gift. And then on the top of it was a little card, and it said, I'll see you Saturday night at 7 o'clock. I'll pick you up. Whoa, what is this? Is this a date? Is it not? I didn't know. It was very ballsy, actually. And so, but come Saturday night, he shows up and it was a date. It was official. So that is when our friendship now morphed into the romance and things changed.
Okay, so this is a question directly from our president, John Kimmins. Why did you choose standard over smooth and rhythm?
We were already married, and she was already a successful dancer. She was in the finals of things. And I told her, I said, I don't want to get into this years later and look like a bad dance teacher. And we had already been training with Augusto, who was coming over to Plano, and we were doing 300 plus lessons a week, and we were training him on how to run schools like that. And we were taking lessons. And I told her, I said, I really want to see what world-class dancing looks like. I want to push it, and I want to have some training underneath me, because, you know, after working with Zach Stevens and her, they were all ballet dancers that were awesome dancers. And, you know, that was the direction that I needed to have some confidence. And it's been really, it was a great blessing. We did it to spend the time and the money together as people and as a person in a relationship. It was a very humbling experience, because to dance against world-class dancers, it was very challenging. I absolutely loved it. And we got a chance to meet with some of the wonderful coaches. We worked with people like you. We worked with Urs Geisenheiner. We worked with so many wonderful people that are part of the Arthur Murray chain and things like that. And it has been a true blessing to dance with this lovely lady. I got a chance to see Augusto in Vegas when he was the world champion. And he was coming to Plano, and I actually got the number of his tailor, and they made me a tail suit in England. And I knew I wasn't going to be like some world champion, but I knew I wanted to look good. I wanted to look better than what I was doing. And I used to go to the competitions and line myself up next to whoever's the best guy at the competition, so that when we first started dancing, that I could take all of the material that I could see on that video. This is for you, John Kimmins. And then I could take that and go home and study it and bring it out to the next coach that came in and said, look, this is number one. I'm, you know, 700th place out there. Tell me what I need to do to get better. And I really saw it as a way to get better. So
all of our waltz videos, you start off and everyone has a natural turn when they start. You see us and Arunas. And then natural turn. And then Arunas is off the frame by the end of the second measure. But for one half of a box, we got to compare.
Yeah, I got you.
If the two of you don't mind, let's talk about staff training, your philosophy, formula, and especially any secrets you have for keeping staff.
So I think the first thing that's important about keeping staff is that you have to hire well, and we look for good people to hire. Everybody wants a good person, but I think sometimes in our industry, people, they want to hire fully formed dancers and then turn them into Arthur Murray teachers. And we've always just applied our philosophy of people first, then dancing, then money into all of our filters of how we run our business. But we do the same thing with hiring. I look for big-hearted people that are full of life, passionate, and that love other people. And we train the dancing and all of the teaching skills. That's the easy part. But hiring a person of quality who really cares about people, that is the first step in creating a really good team. Don't you think so?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so what we look for is we look for really good people. We look for people with good character, okay? It's very interesting. The way that we've always looked for it is we look for team people, the people that want to do things for others, that want to serve others, people that want to do things with the staff. They want to share their students. The people that think it's more important that they do something right for someone else as opposed to serving themselves. And the thing that's very interesting is this. I think it's really easy. When I looked at it when I first started, I was the only teacher. If I didn't show up for work the next day, my students went down the street. And so when we produce teachers, you know, if we have 125 students, our teachers teach all of the students. We share the students, and that for a student, if they come into the studio and that teacher's not there, they take a lesson with someone else. Well, this allows, first of all, teachers to be able to start making a very good income early because their success is not based on their skills, right? Because when you're new, you're new. The next thing is they can take a vacation, you know? We have people on vacation right now, and their students are taking lessons with our other teachers who are their friends. They're not going down the street to the competition, okay? And so when I look at that business, I look for these people. We think of it almost like a hive. The more you give into it, the more that you get back, and it serves us well, and we love the business side of it that way.
In addition to that, I think it's important that there's opportunity for the staff. So when somebody's ready and when they're at a point where they can take that next step, we like to help them do that. We opened another studio in the middle of this pandemic. Okay, we're Looney Tunes, but we had a very promising couple. They were ready and we're holding their hand through this process so that they can grow. And when people see opportunity and they see growth and they see a larger organization that supports that, they stick around.
Britt, your two boys dance. Are they willing participants, and do you think they will both follow in your footsteps?
Oh yeah, the boys are my universe, definitely. They do dance. They are 9 and 11 right now. It's a bit of a negotiation to keep them dancing, but I know that the benefits that being a part of the studio is are huge for developing people, young people. And so outside of unconditional love, I think one of the best things I can do for my sons is bring them into the studio and have them experience that confidence and the physical conditioning and all of it that it is. So they do dance and we have a good time. They do love performing. They just don't like practicing. So I joke with my husband that they're the perfect staff member. But, you know, and as whether they follow in our footsteps, we'll see. You know, they are their own two unique individuals. They've got a lot of great skills and talents. So we'll see where they choose to go. It would be great if they did, but it's going to be great with whatever they do. They're great little boys.
Before we end this fun, great conversation, is there anything else you'd like to share?
You know, I think one thing, in this increasingly disconnected world that we live in, it's really great to be a part of an organization bigger than us that you can kind of connect to and have a community with. I think that's probably one of the best things about Arthur Murray and the reason that I keep, you know, the Arthur Murray lifestyle constantly. And I think it's a great thing to be thankful for and to be grateful for and you know, to make note of. Yeah?
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you so much for asking us to be on here. It was a privilege. had some wonderful moments with you. I'd love to hear your interview. That would be a great one. I don't know who would do it. Maybe I would do it, right? But thank you so much for asking us, and we really appreciate it to Earth Marine International.
Britt and Douglas, thank you so much for taking this time to share your knowledge and experiences, and especially for all the heart and soul you put into your training. We wish you, your staff, and family continued success, and I look forward to seeing you soon, hopefully in person.
Thanks again. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for watching and supporting this lifestyle series. Stay safe, and I can't wait to see you on the next episode.